Hello, this is a Clockwork Orange reading by Nolan, originally written by Anthony Burgess, 1962. This is the UK edition, and I'll be reading it. Part 1. What's it going to be then, eh? There was me, that is Alex, and my three droogs, that is Pete, Georgie, and Dim. Dim being really dim, and we sat in the Corova Milk Bar, making up our Rustadukes, what to do with the evening. A flip dark chill winter bastard through dry. The co-part one Rova Milk Bar was a milk plus mesto, and you may say, oh, my brothers have forgotten what these mestos were like. Things changing so scory these days, and everybody very quick to forget. Newspapers not being read much either. Well, what they sold there was milk plus something else. They had no license for selling liquor, but there was no law against prodding some of the new fishies, which they used to put in the old Malacca, so you could peat it with Velocet or Synthmesk or a Drench Crom or one of two other fishes, which would give you a quite nice quiet horror show, 15 minutes admiring Bog and all his holy angels and saints, and your left shoe with lights bursting all over your mosque. Or you could peat milk with knives in it, as we used to say, and this would sharpen you up and make you ready for a bit of dirty 20-1, and that was what we are peating this evening. I'm starting off the story with. Our pockets were full of dang, so there was no real need from the point of view of crafting any more Pretty Polly to Tolchok some old Vec in an alley and vidy him swin in his blood while we counted the takings and divided by four, nor to do the ultra violent on some shivering, starry, gray haired Tzitza in a shop and go smacking off with the tail's guts. But as they say, money isn't everything. The four of us were dressed in the height of fashion, which in those days was a pair of black, very tight pants with the old jelly mold, as we called it, fitting on the crotch underneath the tights, this being to protect and also a sort of a design you could vidy clear enough in a certain light so that I had one in the shape of a spider. Pete had a rooker, a hand that is, Georgie had a very fancy one of a flower, and poor old Dim had a very hound and horny one of the Clausolizzo face, that is. Dim not having ever having much of an idea of things and being, beyond all shadow of a doubting Thomas, the dimmest of we four. Then we wore waisty jackets without lapels, but with these very big built-up shoulders, plechos, we called them, which were kind of a mockery of having real shoulders like that. Then, my brothers, we had these off-white cravats, which looked like whipped-up kartoffel or spud with a sort of a design made on it with a fork. We wore our hair not too long, and we had flip horse show boots for kicking. What's it going to be then, eh? There were three dvochkas sitting at a corner at a counter altogether, but there were four of us, malchiks, and it was usually like one for all and all for one. These sharps were dressed in the height of fashion, too, with purple and green and orange wigs on their gullivers, each one not costing less than 3 or 4 weeks of those sharp wages, I should reckon, and make up to match rainbows round the glazies, that is, in the wrought, painted very wide. Then they had long, black, very straight dresses, and on the groody part of them they had little badges of like silver with different Malchik's names on them. And Joe and Mike and such like. They're supposed to be the names of the different Malchiks they'd spatted with before they were 14. They kept looking our way, and I nearly felt like saying the three of us, out of the corner of my rot that is, should go off for a bit of pull and leave poor old Dim behind, because it would be just a matter of coupetting Dim a demi-liter of white, but this time with a dollop of synthmesque in it. But that wouldn't really have been playing like the game. Dim was very, very ugly and like his name, but he was a short horror show, filthy fighter, and very handy with the boot. What's it going to be then, eh? The Chelovec is sitting next to me, there being this long, big, plushy seat that ran round three rolls, was well away with the glazies, glazed and sort of burbling, Slovos-like. Aristotle, wishy-washy, works out cyclamen, get four fix. Quite smart fish. He was in the land all right, well away, in orbit, and I knew what it was like, having tried it like everybody else had done, but at this time I'd got to thinking it was a cowardly sort of fish, Oh, my brothers, you lay there after you drunk the old Malacco, and then you got the messel that everything all around you was sort of in the past. You could vidy it all right, of course, very clear tables, the stereo, the lights, the sharps, and the malchicks. But it was like some sore, it was like some vish that used to be there, but was not there, not no more. And you were sort of hypnotized by your boot or shoe or fingernail, as it might be. And at the same time, you were sort of picked up by the old scruff and shook like you might be a cat. You got shook and shook till there was nothing left. You lost your name and your body and yourself, and you just didn't care. And you waited until your boot or fingernail got yellow, then yeller and yeller all the time. Then the lights started crackling like atomics in the boot of a fingernail. In the boot or fingernail, or as it might be, a bit of dirt on your trouser bottom turned into a big, big, big mesto, bigger than the whole world, and you were just going to get introduced to old Bog, or God, when it was all over. You came back to here, and now whimpering sort of with your rot, all squaring up for a boo-hoo-hoo. Now that's very nice, but very cowardly. You were not put on this earth just to get in touch with God. That sort of thing could sap all the strength and the goodness out of a Chevalek. Chelovek. What's it going to be then, eh? The stereo was on, and you got the idea that the singer's gloss was moving from one part of the bar to another, flying up to the ceiling and then swooping down again and whizzing from wall to wall. It was Bertie Lasky rasping a real starry oldie called Ye Blister My Paint, one of the three tzitzas at the counter, the one with the green wig, kept pushing her belly out and pulling it in time to what they called the music. I could feel the knives in the old Malacco starting to prick, and now I was ready for a bit of 20-1, so I yelped, out, 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 like a doggy, and then I cracked this vec, who was sitting next to me and well away and burbling a horror show crack on the echo or ear hole, but he didn't feel it and went on with his telephonic hardware, and when the farfical gets rub-a-dub-dub, he'd feel it all right when he came to, out of the land. Well, we're out, said Georgie. Oh, just to keep walking, I said, and vidy what turns up, oh, my little brothers. So he scattered out into the big winter notchy and walked down Marganita Boulevard and then turned into Bothby Avenue, and there we found what we were pretty well looking for, a monkey just to start off the evening with. There was a daughtery, starry schoolmaster type vec, glasses on in, his rot open to the cold notchy air. He had books under his arm and a crappy umbrella and was coming around the corner from the public biblio, which not many ludies used these days. You never really saw many of the old bourgeoisie type out after nightfall those days, what with the shortage of police and we fine young Malchewicz about, and this prof-type Chelovek was the one walking in this hole of the street. So we gullied up to him, very polite, and I said, "Pardon me, brother." He looked monkey bit poogly when we vidied the four of us like that, coming up so quiet and polite and smiling, but he said, "Yes, what is it?" in a very loud teacher-type gloss, as if he was trying to show us he wasn't poogly. I said, "I see you have books under your arm, brother. It is indeed a rare pleasure these days to come across somebody that still reads, brother." "Oh," he said all shaky, "is it? Oh, I see." And he kept looking from one to the other of we four, finding himself now like in the middle of a very smiling and polite square. "Yes," I said, "it would interest me greatly, brother, if you would kindly allow me to see what books those are that you have under your arm. I like nothing better in this world than a good clean book, brother." "Clean," he said, "clean, eh?" And we Pete scavated these three books from him and handed them round real scory. Being three, we all had one each to vidy at except for Dim. The one I had was called Elementary Crystallography, so I opened it up in it and said, "Excellent, really first class," keeping turning the pages. Then I said in a very shocked type gloss, "But what is this here? What is this filthy Slavo? I blush to look at this word. You disappoint me, brother. You do, really." "But," he tried, but, "now," said Georgie, "here's what I would call real dirt. There's one Slavo beginning with an F and another with a C. He had a book called The Miracle of the Snowflake. Oh, said poor Dim, spotting over Pete's shoulder and going too far like he always did. It says here what he'd done to her, and there's a picture and all. Why, he said, you're nothing but a filthy, mighted old skite bird. An old man of your age, brother, I said. And I started to rip up the book I'd got, and the others did the same with the ones they had, Dim and Pete doing a tug-of-war with the rhombendral system, the starry prof type began to creech. But those are not mine. Those are the property of the municipality. This is sheer wantonness and vandal work, or some such slobos. And he tried to sort of wrest the books back off of us, which was, like, pathetic. You deserve to be taught a lesson, brother. I said, that you do. This crystal book I had was very tough-bound and hard to raz-raz the two bits. Being real starry and made in days when things were made to last. But I managed to rip the pages up and chuck them in handfuls of, like, snowflakes, though big, all over this creaking old Vec. And then the others did the same with theirs. Old Dim just dancing about like the clown he was. There you are, said Pete. There's the mackerel of the cornflake for you, you dirty reader of filth and nastiness. You naughty old Vec, you, I said. And then we began to filly about with him. Pete held his rookers, and George sort of hooked this rot wide open for him, and Dim yanked out his false zubies, upper and lower. He threw these down on the pavement, and then I treated them to the old boot crush. Though they were hard bastards-like, being made of some new horror show plastic stuff. The old Vec began to make some sort of chumbling shoons. Woof, woof, woof. So Georgie let go of holding his goobers apart and just let him have one in the old toothless rot with his ringy fist, and that made the old Vec start moaning a lot then. Out comes the blood, my brothers. Real beautiful. So all we did then was to pull his outer plates off, stripping him down to his vest and long underpants. Very starry. Dim smacked his head off near, and then Pete kicks him lovely in his pot, and we let him go. He went sort of staggering off, and not having been really too hard of a toll shock, really going, oh, 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 not knowing when or what was what, really, and we had a snigger at him and then rifled through his pockets. Dim dancing around us with his crappy umbrella, meanwhile, but there wasn't much in them. There are a few starry letters, some of them dating right back to 1960 with, my dearest, dearest, and them and all that cheap haka, and a key ring and a starry leaking pen. Old Dim gave up his umbrella dance, and of course had to start reading one of the letters out loud, like to show the empty street he could read. My darling one, he recited, in his very high-type gloss. I shall be thinking of you while you are away, and hope you will remember to wrap up warm when you go out at night. Then he let out a very shoomy schmeck. Ho, ho, ho. Pretending to start wiping his yama with it. All right, I said. Let it go, oh my brothers. And the trousers of the starry Vec, there were only a mikey bit of cutter, money that is. Not more than 3 ghoulies. So we gave all his messy little coin the scatter treatment, it being hencorm to the amount of pretty poly we had on us already. Then we smashed the umbrella and raz-razed his plaities and gave them to the blowing winds, my brothers. And then we'd finished with the starry type Vec. We hadn't done much, I know, but that was only like the start of the evening, and I made no apologies to thee or thine for that. The knives in the milk, plus we're stabbing away nice and horror show now. The next thing was to do the Sammy Act, which was one way to unload some of our cutter so we'd have more of an incentive like for some shop crasting, as well as it being a way of bullying an alibi in advance. So we went into the Duke of New York on Amy Avenue, and sure enough, in the snug there were 3 or 4 old babuchkas peeding their black and suds on state aid. Now we were the very good Malchicks, smiling good, even song to one and all. Though these wrinkled old lighters started to get all shook, their veiny old rookers all trembling round their glasses and making the suds spill on the table. Leave us be, lads, said one of them, her face all mappy with being 1,000 years old. We're only poor old women. But we just made with the zoobies. Flash, flash, flash. sat down, rang the bell, and waited for the boy to come. When he came, all nervous and rubbing his rookers on his grazy apron, we ordered our first four veterans, a veteran being rum and cherry brandy mixed, which was popular just then, some liking a dash of lime in it, that being the Canadian variation. Then I said to the boy, "Give these poor old babushkas over there a nourishing something. Large Scotchman all around, and something to take away." And I poured my pocket of dang all over the table, and the other three did likewise, oh my brothers. So double fire golds were brought in for the scared, starry lighters, and they know not what to do or say. One of them got out, "Thanks, lads," but you could see they thought there was something dirty like coming. Anyway, they were each given a cognier, that is, to take away for each dozen of black and suds left over we didn't purchase, my brothers. And those two were for the oldest, were still saying, "Thanks, lad. It makes it feel real dobby. Poor old Dim the Dim didn't quite pony all of that, but he had nothing to fear, nothing for fear." Off now round the corner to Outley Avenue, and there was the sweets and cancer shop still open. And the whole district had been very quiet on the whole, so the armed militants, such being more north of the real horror show, wonderfully done personalities, they gave you the names called P.B. Shelley, and they were a real like disguise, very special plastic vish, so you get it in your boot. Then three of us went in, Pete keeping Chasta without, not that there was anything to worry about out there. As soon as we launched on the shop, we went for Sloss, who ran it, a big port wine jelly of a Vec, who vidied at once when he was coming in straight for the inside where the telephone was, and perhaps his well-oiled pushka, complete with six dirty rounds. Dim was round the counter, scory as a bird, sending packets of snouty flying and cracking over a big cutout, showing a sharp with all her zoop, and her gruties near hanging out to advertise some new brand of cancers. And then glass going smash, smash, smash. Mother sluice, the wide hashtooks and spit chest, and the things we did for old. "We're only asking," said the other. "Nothing to fight against, really. Everything's still." The night was still. When we got outside of the Duke of New York, a burpling old piashnit or drunkie howling away at the filthy songs of his fathers and going blurp blurp in between as though it might be a filthy old orchestra in his stinking rotten guts. I could never stand to see a moo drunk, whatever his age might be, but more especially when he was real star like this one was. He was sort of flat to the wall, all his plighties were a disgrace, all creased and tidy and covered in cow and mud and filth and stuff. So he got hold of him and cracked him with a few good horse show. The song went, "And I will go back to my darling, when you, my darling, are gone." But then Dim fisted him a few times on his filthy drunkard's rot. He shut up singing and started to creech, "Go on, do me in, you bastard cowards. I don't want to live anyway, not in a stinking world like this one." I told Dim to lay off a bit then, because it used to interest me sometimes to slushy what some of these starry decreps had to say about life in the world. I said, "Oh, and what's stinking about it?" He cried out, "It's a stinking world because it lets the young go on to the old like you done. There's no laws nor order no more." He was creeching out loud and waving his rookers and making real horror show with the slobos, only the odd blurp 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 coming from his kishkas, like something was orbiting within, or like some very rude interrupting sort of a mooch making for shroom. So that this old vet kept sort of threatening it with his fist, saying, "It's no world for any old man any longer, and that means that I'm not one bit scared of you, my boyos, because I'm too drunk to feel the pain if he hit me, and if he kill me, I'll be glad to be dead." We smacked and then grinned, but said nothing, and then he said, "What sort of a world is it at all? Men on the moon and men spinning round the earth like it might be midges round a lamp, and there's not more attention paid to earthly law nor order no more. So your worst you may do, you filthy cowardly hooligans." Then he gave us some lip music, like we'd done to the young Minglesons, and then he started singing again, "Oh dear, dear land, I fought for thee, and brought thee peace and victory." So we cracked him into him, lovely, grinning all over our litzes, but he still went on singing. And then we tripped him, so he lay down flat and heavy, and a bucket load of beer vomit came whooshing out. That was disgusting, so we gave him the boot, one go each. And then it was blood, not song nor vomit, that came out of his filthy old rot. Then we went on our way. It was round by the municipal power plant that we came across Billy Boy and his five droogs. Now, in those days, my brothers, the teaming up was mostly by fours or fives, these being like auto teams, four being a company number for an auto, and six being the outside limit for a gang size. Sometimes gangs would gang up so as to make little monkey armies for big night war, but mostly it was best to roam in these, like, small numbers. Billy Boy was something that made me want to sick just to video his fat grinning litzo, and he had always had this vaughn of a very stale oil that's been used for frying over and over, even when he was dressed in his best plaities like now. They videoed us just as we videoed them, and there was like a very quick wind of watching each other now. This would be real. This would be proper. This would be the Nas, the Uzi, the Brita, not just 50s and boots. Billy Boy and his droog stopped what they were doing, which are just getting ready to perform something on a weepy young tvochka they had there, not more than 10. She creeching away, but with her plenty still on. Billy Boy holding her by one rooker, and his number one, Leo, holding the other. They'd probably just been doing the dirty slava part of the act before getting down to the monkey bit of ultra-violence. When they videoed us coming, they let go of his boo-hooing little pizza, there being plenty more where she came from, and she ran with her thin white legs flashing through the dark, still going, "Oh, oh, oh," I said, smiling very wide and droogy. "Well, if it isn't fat, stinky Billy Goat, Billy Boy in poison. How art thou, thou globby bottle of cheap, stinking chip oil? Come and get one of the yarbles. If you have any yarbles, you itch, you onuk, jelly thou." And the way started. There were four of us to six of them, like I had already indicated, but poor old Dim, for all his dimness, was worthy three of the others in sheer madness and dirty fighting. Dim had a real horse show length of Uzi or chain round his waist, twice wound round, and he unwound this and began to swing it beautiful in the eyes of Glazies. Pete and Georgie had good sharp noses, but I had, for my own part, had a fine star horse who cut through at Brita, which at that time I could flash and shine artistic. So there we were drafting away in the dark, the old Luna with men on it, just coming up, the star stabbing away as it might be knives, anxious to join in the drafting. With my briefta, I managed to slit right down the front of one of Billy Boy's Druge's pities, very, very neat, and not even touching the pot underneath the cloth. Then in the dratsing, this droog of Billy Boy's suddenly found himself all open up like a peapod, with his belly bare and his poor old yarble showing. And then he got very raz-draz, waving and screaming and losing his guard and letting in old Dim with his chain snaking, whoosh, so that old Dim chained him right in the clizies. And this droog of Billy Boy's went tottering off and howling his heart out. We were doing very horror show, and soon we had Billy Boy's number one down underfoot, blinded with old Dim's chains and crawlings and howlings about like an animal. But with one fair boot on the go over, he was out and out and out. Of the four of us, Dim, as usual, came out the worst in points of looks. This is to say, his litzo was all bloodied and plaities a dirty mess, but the other of us were still cool and whole. It was stinky, fat, fatty Billy Boy I wanted now, and there I was dancing about him with my breathing like I might be a barber on board a ship on a very rough sea, trying to get in at him with a few fair slashes on his unclean oily litzo. Billy Boy had a nosh, a long flick type, but he was a monkey bit too slow and heavy in his movements to vent anyone really bad. And my brothers, it was a real satisfaction to me to waltz left 2-3, right 2-3, and carve his left cheeky and right cheeky, so that like two curtains of blood seemed to pour out at the same time, one on either side of his fat, filthy, oily snout in the winter starlight. Down this blood poured in like red curtains, but you could vidy Billy Boy and felt not a thing. And he went lumbering on like a filthy, fatty bear, poking at me with his nose. Then we slushied the sirens and knew the militants were coming with pushkas pushing out of the police auto windows at the ready. That weeping little devotchka had told them, no doubt, there being a box for calling the Razas not too far behind the Moody power plant. "Get to you soon, fear not," I called. "Stinky Billy Goat, I'll have your yarbles off, lovely." Then off they ran, slow and panting, except for number one Leo out snoring on the ground, away north towards the river, and we went the other way. Just around the next turning was an alley, dark and empty and open at both ends. We rested there, panting fast and slower, then breathing like normal. It was like resting between the feet of two terrific and very enormous mountains, these being the flat blocks, and in the windows of all these flats you could video like blue dancing light. This would be the telly. Tonight was what they called the worldcast, meaning that the same program was being videoed by everybody in the world that wanted to, that being mostly the middle-aged, middle-class ludies. There would be a big, famous, stupid comic Chilovic or black singer, and it was all being bounced off the special telly satellites in outer space, my brothers. We waved panting, and we could slushy the sirening millicents going east, so we knew we were all right now, but poor old Dim kept looking up at the stars and planets and the lunar, with his rot wide open like a kid who had never videoed any such thing before, and he said, "What's on them, I wonder? What could be up there on things like that?" I nudged him hard, saying, "Come, gloopy bastard as thou art, think thou not of them. There'll be life like down here, most likely, with some getting knifed and others doing the knifing. And now, with the Nachi still melody, let us be on our way, oh my brothers." The others smacked at this, but poor old Dim looked at me serious, then up again at the stars and the Luna. So we went on our way down the alley, with the world cast pulling on... on either side. We needed now was an auto, so we turned left coming out of the alley, knowing right away we were in priestly places as soon as we videoed the big bronze statue of some starry poet with an AP upper lip and a pipe stuck in a droopy old rot. Going north, we came to the filthy old fildrum, peeling and dropping to bits through nobody going there much except malchicks like me and my droogs, and then only for a yell or a rares or a bit of the in and out in the dark. We can video from the poster on the film drum's face a couple of fly dirty spots trained on it. And there's the usual cowboy riot with the archangels on the side of the U.S. Marshals, six shootings at the rustlers out of hell's fighting legions, the kind of hounded horny vish put out by state film in those days. And the autos parked by the cine weren't all that horror show. Crappy, starry vicious, most of them. But there was a newish Durango 95 that I thought might do. Georgie had one of those polychefs, as they called them, on his keyring. So we are soon aboard, Dim and Pete at the back, puffing away lordly at their cancers. And I turned on the ignition and started her up, and she grumbled away real horror show. A nice, warm, vibrity feeling grumbling all through your gutty wits. Then I made with the Noga, and we backed out lovely, and nobody videoed us take off. We fillied around what was called the backtown for a bit, scaring old Vex and Sheenas that were crossing the roads and zigzagging after cats and that. Then we took the road west. There wasn't much traffic about, so I kept pushing the old Noga through the floorboards near, and the Durango 95 ate up and rode like spaghetti. Soon it was winter trees and dark, my brothers, with the country dark, and at one place I ran over something big with a snarling tooth rot in the headlamps. Then it screamed and squelched under an old Dim at the back near and laughed his Gulliver off. Ho 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 at that. Then we saw one young Melchick with a sharp lowly lubbing under a tree, so we stopped and cheered at them. Then we bashed into them both with a couple of half-hearted toll chokes, making them cry. On we went. What we were after now was the old surprise visit. There was a real kick and good for smacks and lashings for the ultraviolet. We came at last to the sort of village, and just outside the village was a small sort... Hold on, I lost my place. Cottage on its own, and with a bit of a garden. The Luna was well up now, and we could video the cottage fine and clear as I eased up and put the brake on. The other three giggling like Bazumi, and we could video the name on the gate of this cottage, which was home, a gloomy sort of a name. I got out of the auto, ordered my drinks to shush. I not their giggles and act like serious, so I opened this malinky gate and walked up to the front door. I knocked nice and gentle, and nobody came, so I knocked a bit more at this time, and I could slushy somebody coming in. Then a bolt drawn, then the door inched open an inch or so I could video this one glass looking out at me, and the door was a chain. "Yes, who is it?" It was a sharp goss, a youngish devotchka by her sound, so I said in a very fine manner of speech, a real gentleman's goss, Pardon, madame. Most sorry to disturb you, but my friend and me were out for a walk. My friend has taken bad all of a sudden, with a very troublesome turn, and he is out there on the road, dead out and groaning. Would you have the goodness to let me use your telephone to telephone for an ambulance? We haven't a telephone, said the Svochka. I'm sorry, but we haven't. We have to go somewhere else. From inside the monkey cottage, I could slushy the clack, clack, clacky, clack, clack, clickety, clack, clack of some vetch typing away. And then the typing stopped, and there was this Chalvex goss calling, "What is it, dear?" "Well," I said, "could you, of your goodness, please let him have a cup of water? It's like a faint, you see. It seems as though he's passed out in some sort of fainting fit." The Devochka sort of hesitated and then said, "Wait," then we went off, and my three droogs had got out of the auto quiet and crept up Horsho stealthy, putting their maskies on now, and then I put on mine. Then it was only a matter of me putting it on the old Rooker and undoing the chain, me having softened up this Devochka with my gents' goas, so that she hadn't shut the door like she had should have done, us being strangers of the night. And the four of us then went roaring, and old Dim playing the chute as usual with his jumping up and down and singing out dirty slobos, and I was there, nice monkey cottage, I'll say that. We all went smacking into the room with a light on, and there was this which was sort of cowering, a young pretty bit of sharp with real horror show grudies on her, and with her was this Chelvek, who was her mooge, youngish too with horn-rimmed ochkis on him, and on a table was a typewriter, and all papers scattered everywhere, but there was one little pile of paper, like, that must have been what he'd already typed. So here was another intelligent type bookman, type like that we'd filled with some hours back, but this was one was a writer, not a reader. Anyway, he said, "What is this? Who are you? How dare you enter my house without permission?" And all the time his ghost was trembling and his rookers too, so I said, "Never fear. I fear thou hast in thy heart, O brother. Pray banish it forthwith. And then Georgie and Pete went out to find the kitchen, while old Dim waited for orders, standing next to me with his rot wide open. "What is it then?" I said, picking up the pile like of typing from off of the table, and the horn-rimmed mooge dithering, "That's just what I want to know. What is this? What do you want? Get out at once before I throw you out." So poor old Dim, masked like P.B. Shelley, had a good luck smack at that, and roaring like some metal. "It's a book," I said. "It's a book what you are writing." I made the old ghost very coarse. I have always had the strongest admiration for them as can write books. Then I looked at its top sheet, and there was the name, A Clockwork Orange. And I said, "That's a fair glippy title. Whoever heard of A Clockwork Orange?" And then I read a monkey bit out loud in a sort of very high type preaching goss, the attempt to impose upon man, a creature of growth and capable of sweetness, to ooze juicily at the last round in beard and lips of God, to attempt to impose, as I say, laws and conditions appropriate to a mechanical creation. Against this, I raised my sword pen. Dim made the old lip music at that, and I had to smack myself. Then I started to tear up on the sheets and scatter the bits over the floor, and this writer, Mooge, went on sort of bizomi, and made for me like his zubies clenched and shining yellow, and his nails ready for me like claws. So that was old Dim's cue, and he went grinning and going, and ah, for this vex-dithering rot, crack, crack. First left fisty, then right, so that our dear old Droog the Red started to pour and spot the nice clean carpet and the bits of his books that I was still ripping away at. Raz, 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 raz. All this time, Miss Tavochka, his loving and faithful wife, just stood like froze by the fireplace, and then he started letting out little munchy creatures, like in time to the like music of old Dim's fisty work. Then Georgie and Pete came in from the kitchen, both munching away. So with their maskies on, you could do that with them on and no trouble. Georgie, with like a cold leg of something in one rooker and half a lid of clout with a big dollop of Moslow on it in the other, and Pete with a bottle of beer frothing its gulliver off and a horse show rooker full of like plum cake. Then we went ha ha ha, vitting old Dim dancing around and fisting the rider vex at the rider vex. Started to patch like his life's work was ruined, going boo hoo hoo with a very square bloody rot. But it was ha-ha-ha in a muffled eater's way. You could see bits of what they were eating. I didn't like that, it being dirty and slobbery, so I said, "Drop that mouch." I gave no permission. grab hold of this Vec here so I can he can video and not get away. So they put down their fatty pitchka on the table among all the flying paper, and they clobbered over to the rider's Vec, whose horn-rimmed orchkeys were cracked but still hanging on, with old Dim dancing round and round, and making ornaments shake on the mantelpiece. I swept them all off, and then they couldn't make shake no more, little brothers. While he filled with an author of A Clockwork Orange, making his litzel all purple and dripping away like some very special sort of a juicy fruit. All right, Dim, I said. Now for the other vesh. Bog, help us all. So we did the strong man on the Dvochka, who was still creech, creech, creeching away in very horse show, four in a bar, and locking her rooks from the back, while I ripped away at this and that and the other, and the others going, ha, 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 still, and real good horse show grooties they were, that then exhibited their pink glazies, oh my brothers, while I untrust and got ready for the plunge, plunging. I could slushy cries of agony at this rider, bleeding Vec that Georgie and Pete held onto nearly got loose howling, bazooming the filthiest of slobos that I already knew, and others he was making up. And then after me, it was right old Dim should have his turn, which he did in a beasty, snorty, howly sort of a way, which is PB Shelly Mass taking no notice, while I held onto her. Then there was a changeover, Dim and me grabbing the slobbering rider Vec, who was past struggling, really, only just coming out with slack sort of slobbers like he was in the land of Milk Plus Bar, and Pete and Georgie had theirs. Then there was a light quiet, and we were full of like hate, so smashed what was left to be smashed. Typewriter, lamp, chairs, and Dim. It was typical of old Dim. Watered the fire out, and was going to dun on the carpet, there being plenty of paper. But I said, no. Out, 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 I howled. The writer of Vec and his, you know, were not really there, bloody and torn and making noises, but they'd live. So we got into the waiting auto and left it to Geordie to take the wheel, me feeling that lanky bit shagged. We went back to town, running over old odd squinting things on the way. We yakked it on back towards my brother's, but just outside, not far from being what they called the industrial canal. We vinnied the fuel needle at like had like collapsed, like our own ha 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 needles had, and the auto was coughing kushel, not to worry over much, though, because the rail station kept flashing blue on off and off, just near. The point was whether to leave the auto to be sobriety by the roses or us feeling in a hate and murder mood. Think of it a fair toll chalk into the starry waters for nice, heavy, loud plastic before the depth of the evening. This latter we decided on. So we got out, and the brakes off, all four toll-chocked into the edge of the filthy water that was like treacle mixed with human hole products. Then one good horse showed toll-chock, and then she went. We had to dash back for fear of the filth splashing on our plighties, but splush and glop. He went down and lovely. Farewell, old droog, called Georgie, and obliged with a clowny great guff. Ho, 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 ho. Then we made for the station to ride the one stop to center, as the middle of the town was called. We paid our fares nice and polite, and waited gentlemanly and quiet on the platform. Old Dim filling with the slot machines, his carbons being full of small monkey coin, and ready, if need be, to distribute chalk bars to the poor and the starving, though there are none such about. And then the old espresso rapido came lumbering in, and we climbed aboard, the train looking to be near empty. To pass the 3-minute ride, we fillied about with what they called the upholstery, doing some nice horse show, tearing out of the seat's guts an old Dim, chaining the okno till the glass cracked and sparkled in the winter air. But we were all feeling the bit shagged and fagged and fashed, it having been an evening of some small energy and expenditure. My brother's only Dim, like the clowny animal he was, full of joys of, but looking all dirtied over and too much vaughn of sweat on him, which was one thing I had against old Dim. We got out at center and walked back slowly to the Corova milk bar, all going, yaw, a monkey bitten, exhibiting to moon and star and lamplight our back fillings, because we were still only growing mouth chicks and had school in the daytime. But when we got into the Corova, we found it fuller than we'd left earlier on, but the Chelovec had been burbling away in the land on white and some mask or whatever, was still on it, going, urchkins of dead cast and the woe hey hey globe. Platonic time weatherborn. It was probable that this was his third or fourth lot that evening, for he had a pale and human look, like he'd become a thing, and like his litza was really a piece of chalk carved. Really, if he wanted to spend so long in the land, he should have gone into one of the private cubbies at the back and not stayed in the big mesto, because here some of the Malchickies were filly about with him a monkey bit. No, not too much, because there are powerful bruised boys hidden away in the old Corova, who could stop any ride. Anyway, Dim squeezed him next to the speck, and with his big clonsy yasp that showed his hanging grape, he stabbed his vex foot with his own large filthy sabog. But the vec, my brothers, heard not, being now all above the body. It was Nadsat's milking and coaching and filling around. Nadsat's were what we used to call the teens, but there were a few of the more starry ones, vex and cheetahs alike, but not of the bourgeoisie, never them, laughing and gouverting at the bar. You could tell them from their barberings and loose plighties. Big, stringy sweaters mostly, that had been in rehearsals at the TV studios standing around the corner. The Dvochkas among them had been very lively litzos and wide big rots, very red, showing a lot of teeth, and smacking away and not caring about the wicked world one whit. And then the disc on the stereo twanged off and out. It was Johnny Zhaga, a Rusky Hotzka singing only every other day. And in the like interval, the short silence between the next one came on. One of these Dvochkas, very fair and with a big smiling red rot, and in her late 30s, I'd say, suddenly came with a burst of singing. Only a bar and a half, and though as though she was like giving an example of something they'd all been go-averting about, and it was like for a moment, oh my brothers, some great bird had flown into the milk bar. And I felt all the little Malinsky hairs of my pot standing endwise, and the shivers crawling up like some blanking lizards, and then slow down again, because I knew what she'd sang. It was from an opera by Frederick Gitter Fadster called Das Bitzig, and it was the bit she was snuffing it with her throat cut, and the slivers are better like this, maybe. Anyway, I shivered. But old Dim, as soon as he'd slushied the stove of song like a lomtick of red-hot meat plonked on your plate, let off one of his vulgarities, which in this case was a lip trump followed by a dog howl, followed by two fingers pronging twice in the air, followed by a clowning guffaw. I felt myself all of a fever, and like drowning in red-hot blood, slushing and fitting Dim's vulgarity, and I said, "Bastard! Filthy, drooling, mannerless bastard!" And then I leaned across Georgie, who was between me and horrible Dim, and fisted Dim, scoring on the rot. Dim looked very surprised, his rot open, wiping the cravy off his goop with his rook, and in turning looked surprised at the red flowing cravy at me. "What for you did you do that for?" he said in his ignorant way. Not many videoed what I'd done, and those that videoed cared not. The stereo wasn't again and played a very sick electronic guitar vish. I said, "For being a bastard with no manners and not the truth of an idea how to comport yourself public-wise over my brother." And Dim put on a hound and horny look of evil, saying, "I don't like you should do what you've done then, and I'm not your brother no more and wouldn't want to be." He'd taken a big snotty tosh took from his pocket and was mopping the red flow, puzzled. Keep on looking at it, frowning as if he thought the pun was for other vex, not for him. It was like he was singing blood to make up for his vulgarity when that Dvochka was singing music. But the Dvochka was smacking away ha 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 now with her drugs at the bar, her red heart working under his subies a shine, not having noticed Dim's filthy vulgarity. "It was me, really, Dim had done wrong to," I said. "If you don't like this, then you wouldn't want, then you... And you wouldn't want that, then you know what to do, my little brother," Georgie said in a sharp way that made me look. "All right, let's not be starting." "That's clean up to Dim," I said. "Dim can't go on all his G's knee being a little child." And I looked sharp at Georgie, Dim said, and the red crobby was easing its flow now. "What natural right does he think he to have that he can give his orders and toll-chuck me whenever he likes? Yarbus was what I say to him, and I'd chain his glossies out as soon as look." "Watch that," I said, as quiet as I could, with a stare bouncing all over the wall, ceiling, and then in the land vec beyond Dim, getting loud now with his spark near alto pentant, I said. "And to watch that, O Dim, if to continue to be on lives out of swish." "Yarble," said Dim, sneering. "Great bullshit yarblockos to you. What you have done, and then you had no right. I'll meet you with chain or nause or briefed at any time. Not having you aiming tolchocks on me, ransomless, reasonless, it stands to reason, I wouldn't have it." "Oh, no, scrap any time you say," I snarled back. Pete said, "Oh, now, don't, both of you malchicks, droogs, aren't we? It isn't right droogs should behave this wise. See, there are some loose-lipped malchicks over there smacking at us, leering like, we mustn't let ourselves down." "Dim," I said, "has got to learn his place, right?" "Wait," said Georgie, "what is all this about place? This is the first I ever heard Ludies learning their place." P said, "If the truth is known, Alex, you shouldn't have given Dim the uncalled-for tolchuck. I'll say it once and no more, and I say it with respect. But if you'd given me, I'd given it to you, and you'd have to answer. I say no more," and he drowned his litso in his milk glass. I could feel myself getting all razz-drazz inside, but I tried to cover it, saying calm. "There's to be a leader. Discipline there has to be, right? None of them scatrazzed a word or nodded even. I got the more razz-drazz inside, calmer out. I said, "have been in charge long now. We are all droogs, but somebody has to be in charge, right? Right?" Thou nodded, where, like, Dim was eschewing the last of the crevy off. It was Dim who said now, "Right, right, deeb-deeb. A bit tired, maybe everybody is. Best not to say more." I was surprised and just monkey bit poogly to slosh Dim gibberting that wise, Dim said. "Bidways is right ways now, so we best get home ways, right?" I was very surprised. The other two nodded, going right, 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 I said. "You understand about the toll trucks on the rot of them, Dim?" It was the music, see. I got all bazoomy when any vex interferes with the pizza singing, as might be, like that then. "Best we go off home ways and get a bit of spotchka," said Dim. "Long night for growing matrix, right?" "Right?" nodded the other two. I said, "I think it's best we go home now. Dim has made a real horse show suggestion. If we don't meet day-wise, oh my brothers, well then, same time, same place tomorrow." "Oh yes," said Georgie, "I think that could be arranged." "I might," said Dim, "be just that blinky late, blinky bit late. But same place, near some time tomorrow, surely. He's wiping in his goober, though no crappie float any longer now. And, he said, it is to be hoped that there won't be any more singing seatses in there. Then he gave his old dim guff a clowny big ho ho ho. It seemed like he was too dim to take much offense. So off we went our several ways, me belching ogh on the cold coke I'd peated. I had my cutthroat brief to handy in case of any Billy Boy's drags. Should be around the near the flat block waiting. Well, for me, that matter, and any of my bandas or groupas or shakers that from time to time were with one. Where I lived was with my dad and mom in the flats of municipal block, flat block 18A between Kingsley Avenue and Wilson's Way. I got to the big main door with no trouble, though I didn't pass one young mouchick sprawling and cheeching and moaning in the gutter, all cut about lovely, and saw in the lamplight also streaks of blood there, and they were like signatures of my brothers on the night's filling. Until I saw just by 18A, a pair of Vochka's knees, doubtless rudely wrenched off in the heat of a moment of my brothers, and so in the hallways was the good old municipal paintings on the walls. Vicks and pizzas were very well developed, stern the dignity of labor at work, bench and machine, with not one stitch of Pleiades on their well developed plots. But of course, some of the Malchiks living in 18A had, as was to be expected, embellished and decorated them, said big painting with handy pencil and ballpoint, adding hair and stiff rods and dirty ballooning slavos out of the dignified rots of these Nagoy, bear that is, chinas and vex. I went to the lift, but there was no need to press the electric knopsa to see if I was working or not, because it had been toll-chalked to real horror show this night. The metal doors had buckled. It all buckled. Some feet of rare strength indeed. So I had to walk the 10 floors up. I cursed and panted climbing, being tired in pot, if not so much in brain. I wanted music very bad this evening, that singing to Vochka in the Krova having perhaps started me off. I wanted like a big feast of it before getting my passport stamped, my brothers, at Sleep's Frontier, and the strippy chest lifted to let me through. I opened the door of 10A with my own little clutch, and inside our malinky quarters all was quiet, the P&M being both in sleep end, and Mom had laid out on the table a lanky bit of supper, a couple of lom ticks of tin sponge, meat with a shrive or so of club and butter, a glass of the old cold Morocco, ho ho ho, the old Morocco, with no knives, and synth escort direct rum in it. How wicked, my brothers, innocent milk must always seem to me now. Still, I drank and ate, growling, being more hungry than I thought at first, and I got fruit pie from the larder and tore chunks of it off and stuffed my greedy rot. Then I tooth cleaned and clicked, cleaning out the old rot with my yas ticker tongue. And then I went to my old little room, or den, easing off my Pleiades as I did so. Here was my bed and my stereo, pride of my jeezney, and my discs in their cupboard and banners and flags on the wall, these being like remembrances of my corrective school life since I was 11, of my brothers, each one shy and blazoned with a name or number, South 4 Metro Core School, Blue Division, the Boys of Alpha. The little speakers of my stereo were all arranged around the room on ceiling, walls, floors, soloing. On my bed is shlewing the music. I was so enlightened by enmeshed in the orchestra. Now what I fancied first tonight was this new violin concerto by the American Geoffrey Plautus, played by Odysseus Coriolis with the Macon, Georgia Philharmonic. So I slid it out from where it was neatly filed and switched on and waited. Then, brothers, it came. Oh, bliss, bliss in heaven. I lay all Nagoy to the ceiling, my Gulliver on my Rookers on the pillow, glazies closed, raw open in bliss, sluicing the sluice of lovely sounds. Oh, it was gorgeousness and gorgiosity made flesh. The trombones crunched red gold under my bed, and behind my Gulliver the trumpets three wise silver flamed, and there by the door the timps rolling through my guts, and now again like it crunched like candy thunder. Oh, it was wonder of wonders. And then a bird of like rare spun heaven metal, or like silvery wine flowing in a spaceship, gravity all nonsense now, came the violin solo above all other strings, and those strings were like a cage of silk around my bed, then flute and oboe board, like worms of like platinum into the thick, thick, toffee gold and silver. I was in such bliss, my brother. Pete and them in the bedroom next door had learned now not to knock on the wall with complaints of what they called noise. I had taught them. Now they would take sleep pills, perhaps knowing the joy I had in my night on music. They had already taken them, as I sloshed my glazes tight shut to shut in the bliss that was better than any synthetic bog or god. I knew such lovely pictures. They were Vex and Pizzas, both young and starry, laying on the ground screaming for mercy, and I was smacking all over my rocks and grinding my boots in their litzes. There were Vodkas ripped and creaking against walls, and I plunging like a shag into them. Indeed, when the music, which was one moment only, rose to the top of its big high tower, and then laying there on my bed with glazies tight shut and Rookers behind my goal, I broke and spattered and cried, ah, with the bliss of it, and so the lovely music glided to its growing clothes. And after that, I had lovely Mozart, the Jupiter, and there were new pictures of different litzos to be ground and splashed, and it was after this that I thought I might have just done one last disc going before crossing the border, and I wanted something starry and strong and very firm. So it was J. S. Bach I had the Brandenburg Concerto, just for middle and lower strings, and sloshing with different bliss than before. I vetted again his name on the paper I'd hazarded that night, a long, long time ago it seemed, in that cottage called home. The name was about a Clockwork Orange. Listening to the J.S. Bach, I began to pony better what they meant now, and I thought, sloshing again to the brown gorgeousness of the starry German master, that I would like to have toll-shocked them both harder and ripped them to ribbons on their own floor. The next morning, I woke up in 08:00 hours, my brothers, and I still felt shagged and fagged and fashed and bashed, and my glasses were stuck to the real horse show with the sleep glue. I thought I would not go to school. I thought how I would have a lanky bit longer in bed, an hour or two, say, and then get dressed nice and easy, perhaps even having a splash about in the bath, make toast for myself, and slushy the radio, read the Gazette on my Audi Naki. And then in the after lunch, I might perhaps, if I still felt like it, itty off to the old scollywally and see what was veriting in the great sight of gloopy useless learning. Oh, my brothers, I heard my papa grumbling and trampling, and then itting off to the dry works where he rounded. And then my mom called in a very respectful glosses, as she now. I was growing up big and strong. It's gone 8, son. You don't want to be late again, so I called back. A bit of pain in my gulliver. Leave us be, and I'll try to sleep it off, and then I'll be right as daughters for this after. I slushied her and gave a sort of a sigh, and then she said, I'll put your breakfast in the oven then, son. I've got to be off myself now. Which was true, there being this law for everybody not a child nor with child nor ill to go out rabbiting. My mom worked at one of the state marts, as they called them, filling up the shelves with tinned soup and beans and all that cow. So I slushied about her clank a plate in the gas oven like, and then she was putting her shoes on and then getting her coat from behind the door, and then sighing off. Then she said, I'm off now, son. And but I let on to be back and sleep in, and then I did doze off real horseshoe. And I had a queer and very like Sneedy dreaming for some reason of my Drew Georgie. And this Sneedy, he got like very much older and very sharp and hard, was converting about discipline and obedience, and how all the mouchicks under his control had to jump hard at it and throw up the old salute like being in the army. And there was me in line like the rest, saying yes, sir, no, sir. And they vidied clear, and I vidied clear that Georgie had these stars on his plushos, and he was like a general. And then he brought an old Dim with a whip, and Dim was a lot more starry and gray, and a few zubies missing as you can see, when he let out a smack of hitting me, and then my droog, Georgie said, pointing like me, "That man has filth and caul all over his plighties." And it was true that I creeched, "Don't hit, please don't, brothers," and started to run. And I was running in like circles, and Dim was after me, smacking his goal over off, cracking with the old whip. And each time I got a real whore or show told chalk with his whip, there was like very loud electric bell ringing tearing. And his bell was like a sort of a pain, too. Then I woke up real scory, my heart being going bap, bap, bap. And of course, there was really a bell going brr, and it was our front doorbell. I let on that nobody was home, but this brr still idiot on, and then I heard a Glossus shouting through the door, "Come on, then, get out of it. I know you're in bed. I recognize this Gloss right away." It was the Gloss of PR Deltoid, a real gloopy as that one, and what they called my post-corrective advisor, an overchecked vetch with hundreds on his books. I shouted right, 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 in a Gloss of like pain, and I got out of bed and attired myself, oh, my brothers, in a very lovely overgown of like silk, with designs of like cities all over this overgrown. Then I put my nogas on, very comfy woolly tofels, combined my luscious glory, and was ready for PR Deltoid. When I opened up, he came shambling in, looking shagged, a battered old shop on his goalwear, his raincoat filthy. "Ah, Alex boy," he said to me. "I met your mother, yes. She had something about a pain somewhere, hence not at shore, yes? Rather intolerable pain in my head, brother sir," I said in my gentleman's gloss. "I think it should clear by this afternoon." "Oh, certainly by this evening, yes," said PR Deltoid. "The evening is the cray time, isn't it, Alex boy? Sit," he said. "Sit, sit," as though this was a dummy and me his guest. And he sat in the starry rocking chair of my dad's and began rocking, as if that was all he had come for. I said, "A cup of the old chai, sir. Tea, I mean." "No time," he said, and he rocked, giving me the old glint under frowning brows, as with all the time in the world. "No time, yes," he said, gloopy. So I put the kettle on, and then I said, "To what do I own the extreme pleasures? Anything wrong, sir?" "Wrong," he said, very scoring sly, sort of hunched, looking at me, but still rocking away. Then he caught sight of an advert in the Gazette, which was on the table, a lovely smacking young pizza and her goodies hanging out to advertise, my brothers, the glories of the Yugoslav beaches. Then, after sort of eating up in two swallows, he said, "Why should you think in terms of there being anything wrong? Have you done something you shouldn't?" "Yes, just a matter of speech," I said, "sir." "Well," said PR Deltoid, "it's just a matter of speech from me to you that you watch out, little Alex, because next time, as you very well know, it's not going to be the corrective school anymore. Next time it's going to be a Barry place and all my work ruined. You have no consideration for your horrible self. You might at least have some for me, who have sweated over you. A big black mark, I tell you in confidence, for everyone we don't reclaim. A confession of failure for every one of you that ends up in the stripy hole." "I've been doing nothing. I shouldn't, sir," I said. "The Millicents have nothing on me, brother. Sir, I mean..." "You can have this clever talk about Millicents," said PR Deltoid, very wary, but still rocking. "Just because the police have not picked you up lately, doesn't, as you very well know, mean you've not been up to some nastiness. There was a bit of a fight last night, wasn't there? There's a bit of a shuffling with noshes and bike chains and the like. One of the certain fat boy's friends was ambulanced off late from near the power plant and hospitalized. Cut about very unpleasantly, yes. Your name was mentioned, and the word has gotten through to me by usual channels. Certain friends of yours were named also. There seems to have been a fair amount of assorted nastiness last night. Oh, nobody can prove anything about anybody, as usual. But I'm warning you, little Alex, be a good friend to you as always. The one man in the sick and soul community who wants to save you from yourself. I appreciate all that, sir, I said, very sincerely. Yes, you don't you? He sort of sneered. Just watch it. Yes, you do, don't you? He sort of sneered. Just watch it, that's all. Yes, we know more than you think, little Alex. Then he said in a sort of great, sort of suffering, but still rocking away, what gets into you all? We study the problem. We've been studying it for damn well near a century, but we have got no farther in our studies. You've got a good home here, good loving parents. You've got not too bad of a brain. Is it some devil that crawls inside of you? And nobody's got anything on me, sir. I've been out of the rookers of the Millicents for a long time now. That's just what murders me, sighed PR Deltoid. a bit too long of a time to be healthy. You're about due now, by my reckoning. That's why I'm warning you, little Alex, to keep your handsome young proboscis out of the dirt, yes? Do I make myself clear?
As an unmuddied lake, sir, I said. Clear as an azure sky of deepest summer. You could rely on me, sir. And I gave him a nice, zooby smile. But when he oogadeeded and I was making this very strong pot of chai, I grinned to myself over this fetch that Pierre Deltoid and Drew is worried about. All right, I do bad, which with crasting and tolchucks and carbs of the burrito and the old In-N-Out. And if I get limited, well, too bad for me. Oh, my little brothers. And you can't run a country with every showman comporting himself in any manner of the night. So if I get limited and it's 3 months in the mesto and another 6 in that, and as Pierre Deltoid so kindly warns next time, in spite of the great tenderness of my summer's brothers, it's the great unearthly zoo itself, will I say. Fair, but to pity, my lords, because I just cannot bear to be shut in, my endeavors shall be. In such future it stretches out like snowy and lily-white arms to me before the notch overtakes or the blood splatter in its final course in twisted metal and smashed glass on the high road to not get levitted again, which is fair speeching. But brothers, this biting of their toenails over what is the cause of badness is what turns me into a fine laughing malchick. They don't go into the cause of goodness, so why the other shop? If ladies are good, that's because they like it, and I wouldn't ever interfere with their pleasures, and so off the other shop. And I was a patronizing the other shop more. Badness is of the show, of the self, the one, the you or me on her oddy knockies, and that self is made by old Bog or God. And is the great pride and modesty, but the not self cannot have the bad, meaning they of the government and the judges, and the schools cannot allow the bad because they cannot allow the self. And is it not our modern history, my brothers, the story of brave monkey souls fighting these big machines? I'm serious with you, brothers, over this, but what I do, I do because I like to do.
So now, this smiling winter morning, I drink this very strong chai with Molko and spoon after spoon after spoon of sugar, me having a slodky deuce, and I dragged out of there the breakfast that my poor old mom had cooked for me. It was egg fried, that no more, but I made toast and egg and toast and jam, smacking away at it while I read the Gazetta. The Gazetta was the usual about ultra-violence and bank robberies and strife and footballers making everybody paralytic with fright by threatening to not play next Saturday if they did not get higher wages, naughty mouchy weeks as they were. Also, there were no space trips and bigger stereo TV screens and offers of free packets of soap flakes in exchange for the labels on soup tins, amazing offer for 1 week only, which made me smack. And there was a bullshit big article on Modern Youth meaning me, so I gave the old bow, grinning like Bazumi, by some very clever bald Vichelovic. I read this with care, my brother, slipping away at the old chai, cup after tass after chashka, crunching my lumpticks of black toast dipping into jammy lemon eggy wig. This learned Vec said the usual Vichkas about no parental discipline, as they called, and the shortages of real horror show teachers and lambast bloody beggary out of their innocent poops and make them go boo-hoo for mercy. All this was gloopy and made me schmeck, but it was alike nice to go out knowing one was making the news all the time on my brothers. Every day there's something about Modern Youth, but the best vesh they ever had in the old Gazetta was by some starry pop in a doggy collar who said that in his considered opinion, and he was governing as a man of bog, it was the devil that was abroad and was like fretting his way into like youth innocent flesh, and it was the adult world that could take the responsibility for this with their wars and bombs and nonsense. So that was all right. So he knew what he talked of, being a godman. So we young innocent malchicks could take no blame. Right, right, right. When he had gotten a couple of razzes on my full innocent stomach, I started to get out day plaidies for my wardrobe.
my wardrobe, turning the radio on, and there was music playing, a very nice blanky, string quartets, my brothers, by Claudius Birdman, one that I knew well. I have to have a smick, thought, though, thinking of what I'd videoed once in one of these like articles in Modern Youth, about how modern youth would be better off if a lively appreciation of the arts could be, like, encouraged. Great music, it said, great poetry, would be, like, quieted modern youth down and make modern youth more civilized. Civilized yobbles. Civilized my civilized yarbles. Music always sort of sharpened me up, oh my brothers, and made me feel like old Bog himself, ready to make with the old daughter and Blitz and have Vex and pizzas crunching away in my ha-ha power. And when I'd chested up my Litzo and Rookers a bit done in dressing, and my day plaities were like student wear, the old blue pantalones with a sweater and a frogs, and I thought here at last was time to itty off to the old dish boutique and cut it too, my pockets being full of pretty folly, to see about this long-promised and long-ordered stereo, Beethoven No. 9, the Choral Symphony, that is, recorded on masterstroke by the Esham Cinefoy under El Mahilir. So out I went, brothers. And the day was very different from the night. The night belonged to me and my droogs. All the rest of the Nadsats and starry bourgeoisie lurked indoors, drinking in the old gloopy world cast, but the day was for the starry ones, and there always seemed to be more roses or melons about the Taylor place, and there was a disc boutique I favored with my inestimable custom. Oh, my brothers. It had a gloopy name of Melodia, but it was a real horror show, messed to and scoring most times at getting the new recordings. I walked in the only other customers were two young pizzas, sucking away ice sticks, and this mark was a dead cold winter, and sort of shuffling through the new pop discs. Johnny Burnaway, Stash Crow, the mixers lay quiet a while, and Molotov, and all the rest of that cow. And these two pizzas couldn't have been more than 10, and they too, like me, it seemed evidently, had decided to take the morning off from the old Scullywell. They saw themselves, you see, real grown-up devotees already, with the old hip swing when they saw your old faithful Larry brothers, in padded grooties and red all posh with the goobers. I went out to the counter, making with the polite Zuby smile and old Annie behind it, always play himself, always helpful, a real horror show type of vic. Though bald and very, very thin, he said, "Aha, I know what you want, I think. Good news, it has arrived." And with like big conductor's rickers beating time he went to get in. The two young pizzas started giggling as they will at the age, and I give them a light cold glizzy. And it was real back score, waving the great shining white sleeve of the ninth, which he had on it, brothers, the frowned beetle-like thunderbolt and the stow of Ludwig von himself. "Here," said Andy, "shall we give it a trial spin? But I wanted it back home on my stereo to slush out my old knocky-knocky, greedy as hell." I fumbled at the dang to pay it, and one of the old pizzas said, "Who you getting, Bratty? What biggie? What only?" These young butchkas had their own like way of gavorting. The Heaven 17, Luke Stern, Goggly Goggle, and they both giggled, rocky and hippie. And then an idea hit me, and me near fall over with this anguish and ecstasy of it. Oh, my brother, so I could not breathe for near 10 seconds. I recovered and made with my new clean zoobies and said, "What you got back home, little sisters, to play your fuzzy wobbles on?" Because I could vidy the discs they were buying, those teeny pop fishes. "I bet you got little savvy tiny portable, like, picnic spinners." And they sort of pushed their lower lips out of that. "Come with Uncle," I said, "and here all proper. Here, angels, trumpets, and devil trombones, you're invited." And I, like, bad. They giggled again and said, "Oh, but we're so hungry. Oh, but we could so eat." The other said, "Yeah, she could say that, can't she just?" So I said, "Eat with Uncle, name your place." Then they invented themselves real sophistos, which was like pathetic, and started talking in big lady glosses about the Ritz and the Bristol and the Hilton and the Il Ristorante Gran Turco, but I stopped with that and said, "Follow Uncle." And I let them to the pasta parlor just around the corner, and let them fill the innocent young Litzos on spaghetti and sausages and cream puffs and banana splits and hot dog sauce, till I near sicked with the sight of it. Aye, brothers. Lunching but frugally off.
as cold ham slice and a growing dollop of chili. These two young pizzas were much alike. They're not sisters. They had the same ideas or lack of, and the same color hair. Like dyed strawy. But, well, they could grow up real today. Today, I would make a day of it. No school this after lunch, but educate and certain Alex's teacher. Their names, they said, were Marty and Sonietta. Bizomi enough and in the height of their childish fashion, so I said. Right, right, Marty and Sonietta. Time for the big spin. Come, when we were outside on the cold street, they thought they would go not by the autobus, oh no, but by a taxi. So I give them the humor, though with a real horror show and grin, and I call the taxi from the rank near center. The driver, a starry whiskery vec in the very stained putty, said, no tearing up now, no nonsense with them seats, just reupholster they are. I quieted this gloopy fears and off we spent the municipal flatback 18A. These two bold little pizzas giggling and whispering, so to cut all short, so we arrived, my brothers, and I led them up to the way to 10-8, and they panted and smacked away the way up, and then they were thirsty, they said, so I unlocked the treasure chest to my room, and gave these 10-year young devotees a real horse show Scotchman apiece, though well filled with sneezy pins and sneedles soda. They sat on my bed, yet unmade, and legs swung, smacking and peeting their highballs, while I spun their like pathetic monkey discs through my stereo, like peating some sweet scented kid's drink that was, and like very beautiful and lovely, and costly gold goblets. But they went oh 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 and said, swoony and hilly, and the other slavos that were the height of fashion in that youth group. Well, I spun this cow from them, I encouraged them to drink and have another, and they were nothing loath than my brothers. So by the time their pathetic pop discs had been twice spun each, there were two. Honey Nose, sung by Ike Yard, and night after day after night, moaned by two horrible yarbolists like eunuchs, whose name I forget. They were getting near the pitch of like young teases hysterics, with what jumping all over my bed and me in the room with them. What was actually done that afternoon, there's no need to describe, brothers, as you may easily guess all. These two were unplated and smacking fit to crack in no time at all, and they thought in the bullshiest fun to video old Uncle Alex standing there, all nagoy and panhandled, squirting the hypodermic like some bear doctor, then giving myself the old jab of growling jungle cat secretion in the rooker. Then I pulled the lovely knife out of its sleeve, so that Ludwig van was now nagoy too, and I set the needle hissing on to the last movement, which was all bliss. There it was then, the bass strings like verting away from under my bed at the rest of the orchestra, and then the male human gauze coming in telling them all to be joyful. And then the lovely, blissful tune all about joy being a glorious spark like of heaven, and then I felt the old tiger's leap in me, and then I leapt on these two young pizzas. This time they thought nothing fun and stopped creaking with high mirth and had to submit to the strange and weird desires of Alexander the Large, which, what with the ninth and the hippo jab, was chudisny and zamakot and very demanding, oh my brothers, but they were both very, very drunk and could barely feel very much. When the last movement had gone round for the second time with all the banging and creaching about joy, 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 then these two young pizzas were not acting the big lady's fist no more. They were like waking up to what was being done to their melanchy persons and saying that they wanted to go home and like I was a wild beast. They looked like they had been in some big vita, as indeed they had, and were all bruised and pouty. Well, if they would not go to school, they must still have their education. An education they had. They were curching and going ow, ow, ow as they put their plaities on, and they were like punching me with their tiny fists as I lay these dirty Nagoya and fair shagged and fagged on the bed. This young Sonietta was screeching, beast and hateful animal, filthy whore, so I let them get their things together and get out, which they did, talking about how the roses shouldn't be got onto me and all that call. Then they were going down the stairs and I dropped off to sleep, still with the old joy, 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 crashing and howling away. What happened, though, was that I woke up later near 7:30 by my watch, and as it turned out, I was not so clever. You could vidy about everything in the wicked old world counts. You could pony that one thing and always leads to another. Right. My stereo was no longer on about joy, and I embrace ye, oh, ye millions. So some Vic had dealt it off the off. And that would be neither P or M, but both of them being quite clear to the sloshing in the living room, and from the clink clink of plates and slurp slurp of heating tea from cups at their tired meal after a day's rabbiting in factory, the one store, the other. The poor old, the pitiable story. I put on my overgown and looked out, and guys of loving only son to say, hi there, a lot better after the day's rest. Ready now for the evening work to earn that little bit, for that's what they said they believed I did these days. Yum yum mum. Any of that for me? It was like some frozen pie that she'd unfroze and then warmed up, and it looked not so very appetitish, but I had to say what I did. Then looked at me with a not so please suspicious like look, but said nothing, knowing he dare not, and mom gave me a tired little smack. To thee, fruit of my womb, my only son, sort of. I danced in the bathroom and had a real scory chest all over, feeling dirty and gluey, then back to my den for the evening's plaities, then shining, combed, brushed, and gorgeous. I sat to my long take a pie, Papa said. Not that I want to pry, son, but where it exactly is to you go to work for these evenings? Oh, I chewed, it's mostly odd things, helping like here and there as it might be. I gave him a straight, dirty glizzy as to say to mind his own, I'd mind mine. I never ask for money, do I? Not money for clothes? Or for pleasures? All right, then why ask? My dad was humble mumble chumble. Sorry, son, he said, but I get worried sometimes. Sometimes I have dreams. You can laugh if you like, but there's a lot in dreams. Last night I had this dream with you in it, and I didn't like it one bit. Oh, he had gotten me interested of it now, dreaming of me like that. I had like a feeling like I had a dream too, but I could not remember proper what. Yes, I said, stopping chewing my gooey pie. It was vivid, said my dad. I saw you lying on the street, and you had been beaten by other boys. These boys were like the boys you used to go around with before you were sent to the last corrective school. Oh, I had an ingrim in that, Papa believing I really reformed, or believing he believed. And then I remembered my own dream, which was a dream of that morning of Georgie giving his general's orders, and old Dim smacking around toothless as he wielded the whip. But dreams go by opposites, I was once told. Never worry about thine only son in there, O my father, I said. Fear not, he can't take care of himself. Verily. And, said my dad, you were like helpless in your blood and couldn't fight back. That was my real opposite, so I had another quiet, mocky grin within, and then I took all the dang out of my carbons and tinkled it on the saucy tablecloth. I said, here, Dad, it's not much. It's what I earned last night, but perhaps for the odd pita Scotchman in the snooks somewhere for you and Mum. Thanks, son, he said, but we don't go out much now. We daren't go out much, the streets being what they are, young hooligans and so on. Still, thanks, I brought her home a bottle of something tomorrow. And he scooped this old gotten pretty into his trouser commons, Mum being at the cheesting of the dishes in the dishes in the kitchen, and went out with loving smiles all round. When I got to the bottom of the stairs of the flat block, I was somewhat surprised. As more than that, I opened my rod to like wide in the old stony gapes. They had come to meet me. They were waiting by the all scrawled over municipal wall painting on the dignity of labor, bare vex and chinas stern at the wheels of industry, like I said, with all this dirty dirt penciled from their rots by nardy malt chicks. Dim had a big thick stick of black grease paint and was tracing filthy slobos real big over our municipal painting and doing the old Dim guff wahaha while he did it. But he turned round when Georgie and Pete gave me the well hello, showing their shiny droogie zoobies, and he horned out, here are here. He have arrived, hooray, and did a clumsy turn-a-toe bit of dancing. We got word, said Georgie. There we were, waiting and peeting over the old knifey Morocco, and you might have been, like, offended by some vesture or other, so round we came to your abode. That's right, Pete, right? Oh, yes, right, said Pete. Happy Polly Lodgies, I said carefully. I had something of a pain in the gulliver, so I had to sleep. I was not wakened when I gave orders for wakening. Still, here we all are, ready for what the old Nachi offers, yes. I seem to have picked up that yes from PR Deltoid, my post-corrective advisor. Very strange. Sorry about the pain, said Georgie, like very concerned. Using the gulliver too much, like maybe giving orders and discipline and such, perhaps? Sure the pain is gone, sure you'll not be happier going back to the bed. And they had a bit of a lanky grin. Wait, I said, let's get things nice, sparkling, and clear. nice and sparkling clear. This sarcasm, if you may call it such, does not become you, oh my little friends. And perhaps you have been having a bit of a quiet gavurit behind my back, making your own little joys and such like. Jokes and such like. As I am your Drugan leader, surely I am entitled to know what goes on, eh? Now then, Dim, what does that great big horsey gape of a grim portend? For Dim had his rot open in a sort of bazoomy, soundless smack. Georgie got in a very score with, "All right, no more picking on Dim, brother. That's part of the new way." "New way?" I said. "What's this about a new way?" "There's been some very large talk behind my sleeping back in nowhere. Let me slushy more." And I sort of fondled my ruckers and leaned comfortable to listen against the broken banister well, me being still higher than them, droogs as they call themselves, on the third stair. "No offense, Alex," said Pete, "but we wanted to have things more democratic-like. Not you like saying what to do and what not all the time, but no offense." And George said, "Offense is neither here nor elsewhere. It's the matter of who has ideas. What ideas has he had?" And he kept his very bold glazies turned full on me. "It's all the small stuff, monkey vicious like last night. We're growing up, brothers." "More," I said, not moving. "Let me slushy more." "Well," said Georgie, "if you must have it then. We itty round, shop crasting and the like, coming out with a pitiful rooker full of cutter each. And there's Will the English and the muscle man, coffee mesto, saying he could fence anything that any Malchick cares to try to crast. The shiny stuff, the ice," he said, "still with these like cold glazes on me. The big, big, big money is still available in what is what it, Will the English has." "So," I said, very comfortable. Out but real razdraz within. "Since when have you been consorting, comporting with Will the English?" "Now and again," said Georgie, "I get around all my oddy-knocky. Like last Sabbath, for instance, I can lift my own jizney drugie, right?" "I don't care for any more of this, my brothers." "And what will you do," I said, "with the big, big, big dang or money, as you so half-faulting call it? Have you not every vesh you need? If you need it, otter, you pluck it from the trees. If you need a pretty poll, you take it, yes? Why the sudden shlarney for being the big-blooded capitalist?" "Ah," said Georgie, "you think and govern sometimes like a little child." Dim went, "Huh, huh, huh," at that. "Tonight," said Georgie, "we pull a man-sized crest." So my dream hadn't told truth then. Georgie, the general, saying what we should do and what not do. Dim with the whip as mindless grinning bulldog. But I played with care, with great care. The greatest saying, smiling, "Good, real horse show. Initiative comes to them, though, as wait. I have taught you much, little Georgie. Now tell me what you have in mind, Georgie boy." "Oh," said Georgie, cunning and crafty in his grin, "the old Malacco plus first, would you not say? Something to sharpen us up, boy. But you especially, we having the start on you. You have govern in my thoughts for me," I smiled away. "I was about to suggest the dear old Corova." "Good, good, good, little Georgia. Georgie, and I made with a deep like bow, smiling like Bazumi, but thinking all the time. But when we got into the street, I vidied that thinking is for the gloopy ones, and that the oomny ones use like inspiration what bog sends. For now, it was lovely music that came to my aid. There was an auto eyeing by, and it had its radio on, and I could just slushy a bar or so of Ludwig van. It was the violin concerto last movement, and I vidied right at once what to do. I said in like a thief did gloss, "Right, Georgie, now." And I whisked out my cut-through vita. Georgie said, "Huh?" But he was a score enough with his nas, the blade coming sloosh out of the handle, and we were one to each other. Old Dim said, "Oh, no, not right, that isn't," and made to uncoil the chain round his tally. But Pete said, putting his rooker firm on Old Dim, "Leave them, it's right like that." So then Georgie and your humble did the old quiet cat stalk, looking for openings, knowing each other's style a bit too hoarse, really. Georgie now and then going lurch-lurch with his shining nose, but not no wise connecting. And all the time Ludies passed by and vidied all this minded their own, it being perhaps a common street sight. But then I counted Odin Dvatri and went ock-ock-ock with the burrita, though not on Litzo or Glazies, but at George's nose's holding rooker, then my knight. My little brothers, he dropped his nose with a tinkle-tankle on the hard winter sidewalk. I just tickle-wickled his fingers with my briefta, and he was looking at them monkey dribble of coffee that was running out of the lamplight, and now, I said, and it was me that was starting because Pete had given old Dim the Soviet knot to uncoil the Uvi from round his tally, and Dim had taken it. Now, Dim, let's thou and me have all this now, shall us? And Dim went armed like some bullshit bazoomy animal, and snaked out the chain from his waist, real horse show and scory, so you had to admire. Now the right style for me here was to keep Lou like a frog dancing to protect Linsone Glazies, and this I did, brothers, so that poor old Dim was a lanky bit surprised, him being accustomed to the straight face on lash, lash, lash. Now I will say that he wished me horrible on the back, so that it stung like Bazumi, but that pain told me to dig and score once and for all and be done with old Dim. So I switched with the Brigitte at his left noggin and its very tight sight, and I slashed 2 inches of cloth and drew a lanky drop of curvy to make Dim real Bazumi. Then while he went ha 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 like a doggy, I tried the same style as for Georgie, banking all in one move, up cross cut, and felt the burrito go just deep enough in the meat of old Dim's wrist, and he dropped his shanky oozy yelping like a little child. And then he tried to drink in all the blood from his wrist and howl at the same time, and there was too much crabby to drink, and he went bubble bubble bubble, the red like founding out lovely, but not for very long, I said. Right, my Georgies. Now we should know. Yes, Pete? I never said anything, said Pete. I never converted one slavo. Look, old Dim's bleeding to death. Never, I said. One can die but once. Dim died before he was born. That red, red cravy will soon stop, because I had not cut into the like main cables, and I myself took a clean tosh stick from my carbon to wrap around my round poor old dying Dim's rooker, howling and moaning as he was, and the cravy stopped it like it. Like I said it would, oh my brothers. So they knew now who was master and leader. Sheep, thought I. It did not take long to quicken these two wounded soldiers down in the snug of the Duke of New York. What with large brandies bought with their own cutter, me having given all to my dad, and a wipe with tush tukes dipping in the water jug, the old teetses we'd been so horse show to last night were there again, going, thanks, lads, and God bless you, boys, like they couldn't stop. Though we had not repeated the old Sammy act with them. But P said, what's it to be, girls? And brought black and suds for him seeming to have a fair amount of pretty Polly in his carbons, so they were on louder than ever with their God bless and keep you all, lads. And we never split on you, boys, and the best lads of breathing, that's what you are. And last I said to Georgie, now we're back to where we were, yes? Just like before and all forgotten, right? Right, 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 said Georgie, but old Dim still looked a bit dazed and even said, I could have got that big bastard, see, with my Uzi, only some Vec got in the way, as though he'd been drasting not with me, but with some other Malchik. I said, well, Georgie boy, what did you have in mind? Oh, said Georgie, not tonight, not this nurture, please. Your big, strong Shevelek, I said, like us all, we're not little children, are we, Georgie boy? What then didst thou in thy mind have? I could have chained his glassies real horseshoe, said Dim, and the old babushkas were still on with their thanks, lads. It was this house, see? The one with two lamps outside, the one with the gloomy name, like, what gloopy name? The mansions of the manse are summoning some such piece of a gloop. Where this very starry pizza lives with her cats and all these very starry valuable vishes. Such as gold and silver and like jewels. It was Will the English who, like, said, I vidy horseshoe. I knew where he meant, Oldstown, just beyond Victoria Flatbock. Well, the real horseshoe leader knows, always when like to give and show generous to his like unders. Very good, Georgie, I said. Good thought, and want to be followed. Let us once, Itty. And as we were going out, the old babushka said, well, say nothing, lads. Been here all the time you have, boys, so I said, good old girls, back to buy more in 10 minutes, and so I lend my 3 droogs out to my doom.